Hello everybody and welcome back to another Blender Made Easy tutorial. Today we're going to be creating this paint splash effect using dynamic paint and the fluid simulation. To get started, let's go ahead and delete the cube and then press Shift A and we'll add in another cube. This is going to be the domain for our fluid simulation. We're going to scale it up just a little bit and then place our bottom right corner onto where the cursor is. So I'll just move it up right about there. Looks pretty good. Next, what I'll do is I'll press Shift A and add in a circle, and this is going to be our emitter object. Rotate the circle 90 degrees along the X and then position it inside the cube. So I'll go into wireframe and then I'll scale it down and then just position it right over here and I'll drag it up. Also, make sure you go into edit mode and press F to fill in a face on that circle. You can also extrude it out just to give it some thickness, and this will help with emitting the fluid. Now that we have all of our objects in our scene, let's go ahead and start creating the fluid simulation. So select your domain, go over to the physics tab and add in a fluid and set the type to domain. Don't worry about these settings at the moment, we'll change them in just a second. The other thing that we need to do is select the circle, go fluid and set the type to inflow. This will constantly add fluid into our scene. But I don't want it to be constantly adding fluid, I want it to add a little bit and then just shut off. So to do that, we're going to go to frame 5, right here, frame 5 down here, and then I'm going to hover my mouse over this checkbox and then hit the I key on my keyboard. Next, go to frame 6, uncheck this flow checkbox, and then hit the I key one more time. So over 5 frames, it's going to emit fluid into our scene and then shut itself off. Underneath the Y velocity, we need to change this up to 10. So with the speed of 10, it's going to shoot some fluid out and then hit the wall right here. Next, let's select our domain, and underneath the boundary options, we're going to be turning the subdivisions up to a value of 2. This will enable the fluid to look really nice, but it will also enable us to add in particles. Next, open up the particle tab and set the generate value to 0.01. You want to be careful with this value because the higher you go, it will almost look like an explosion of fluid. So I found that a 0.01 is a pretty good value right here. Next, we can set the resolution by coming up here and changing it to, let's go with 150. That's a pretty decent size and that will give us a lot of geometry to work with. And finally, I'll set the viewport to final so we can actually see what it looks like, and then open up the bake. Here you can set where you want the baking to go to. I'll just set it to this folder. Now before you click bake, make sure you set the end frame down here, and I'm going to be setting this to 150. I don't need to bake 250 frames, so set the end frame to 150 and you'll be good to go. Once you do that, hit bake and it will start. Our baking has finished and this is our result. If I hit the spacebar, we can see what it looks like. And that's not too bad. It might be shooting out a little too quick, but it's okay, we'll work with it. Okay, so the next thing we need to do is add in a couple of objects. The first object that we'll add in is the ground, so I'll add in the plane and just scale it up pretty big. And then we'll add in another plane, and this is going to be the plane that actually interacts with the fluid. So we'll rotate it 90 degrees along the X, and then we'll scale it up and then place it right next to the cube. We want it to be about the same size as the domain, so I'll select the domain, I'll go into edit mode to see what it looks like. Alright, and then I will go into top view. I'll also select this plane here, go back into top view, and then go into edit mode. If we have two objects selected, we can see them both in edit mode, and now what we can do is just Control L on that plane, and then scale it up to be the size that we need, and drag it up as well. Right about there, looks good. Now that we've done that, we can go ahead and play this one more time, and we'll pause it right about there. Go into side view and then just make sure that this plane is actually touching the fluid. As you can see here, there's a small gap, and if we were to use the dynamic paint, it's not going to work because it's not touching. So just drag the plane over until it's right next to the fluid right there. Now we are ready to work with the dynamic paint. Select your plane that you just added and click on dynamic paint. This is going to be the canvas for the simulation. So go ahead and make sure the type is set to canvas and then go add canvas. Underneath here we have a couple different options. The format, we can use the vertices that are on the plane, or we can use an image sequence. Since we only have four vertices, we're going to be using the image sequence, so go ahead and change it to there. Here you can set the resolution of the image you want to output. I'm just going to go with 1080. I find that's pretty good. And the frame we can set here, and it's already at the correct frames, 150, so we don't need to change that. The substeps, we do need to bring that up to 3. This will just help give us a more smooth animation. Underneath that, we have a couple different options for the scale, the radius. We don't really need to worry about any of these. If you wanted to, you can open up the effects and change it to drip, and also an animation on screen of no drip and then drip enabled, and you can see the differences. For this animation, I found that no drip actually looks a little bit better, so I'm going to leave it at no drip. The other option we need to do is the output, so go ahead and open up the output section here and set the cache path where you want your images to go. Once you've selected a folder, go ahead and click on UV map and select the UV map. Make sure pre-multiply alpha is turned on. This will enable us to have images that use alpha, so we can add a texture underneath if we wanted to. Once you've done all that, go ahead and select your fluid, and this is going to be our brush. I'm going to collapse the fluid and then go dynamic paint, set the type to brush, and then go add brush. Here is where you set the color. You can set this to whatever color that you like. I think I'm going to go with a red color somewhere around here, and then I might darken it up just a little bit. And that's basically all we really need to do. If you want it to be a little transparent, you can do that here, but I'm going to leave it at 1. Now that we've done that, we are ready to bake, so go ahead and select your plane, scroll down to the baking output right here, and click Bake Image Sequence. And it will put all of those images into that folder, and then we'll use the Node Editor to import that into the material. Alright, the baking has finished, and here we can see all of our images in this folder, and it goes all the way up to 150. The ones up top here are black, and that just means that they're transparent. There's nothing on them. It's just a completely transparent image. All right, so to apply that to our plane right here, what we need to do is open up the node editor. So go over to the shader editor, press N to close off that panel, and then click on new. With this principled shader, I'm going to press Shift A and add in a texture, and then we see an option here, image sequence. Go ahead and click on that, navigate to where your images are, press A to select them all, and then go import image sequence and place that right here. Now what we need to do is take the color and plug it into the base color of the principled shader. Now if we go into render view, we should be able to see, yeah, we can see it right there, and as we can see, the fluid is also right there as well. Currently though, it's using the transparency and just making it black, and I don't want that. What I want to do is press Shift A, go to color, and then mix RGB and place that here. Then take the alpha channel and plug that into the factor. There we go. And then make sure this is in the bottom input. And there we go. So now we can put whatever we want into this top input. If we want to put in a concrete texture, a wood texture, whatever you want, you can plug that in right here. Or if you want to, just change the color. All right, so I just went ahead and put in a concrete texture right here. And so we have a background for our paint to splash on. Now we need to do the colors for the fluid. If I zoom in here and press Z and go into render view, you'll notice that the paint or the output images look a little bit different than the color we set over here. I'm not sure why this happens, but whenever you output images from the dynamic paint, it changes the color just a little bit. So you can see here we have a dark red color, but over here it almost looks like an orange. So we're going to eyeball it when we select our fluid. We're just going to give it a new material, which it already has. And I'm just going to set this to like an orange color to try to match that color that's on the wall. Now, if you want that exact color, what we can do is open up the UV image editor right here, grab one of our images and just drag it in, and then select that color. So click on this eyedropper tool, click on this, and just select that color. And now it's the exact same color as the paint. And you can see there, it looks pretty good. Now I want to render this in Eevee, so I'm gonna go ahead and switch over to Eevee, there we go. And I'm gonna close that off so we have more space on our 3D view. Now let's set up a quick scene with some lighting, and also make sure that you select the floor and drag it up so it's right next to the fluid so there's no gap between them. Right about there looks good. Okay, I've set up my quick scene right here. I have a sun lamp with a strength of 3 pointing down like this. My camera is directly in front of the scene, and it's a little bit above the floor so we don't see the plane, and everything else looks pretty good. You can also double check that you right click and go shade smooth on your fluid. And if you play this, you'll notice that the back wall doesn't change. That is just a visual thing. Once you actually do the render, it will change. Also, with this sun lamp, make sure you turn on contact shadows over here and your render will look a lot better. For the Eevee settings, I'm going to turn on ambient occlusion, I'm going to turn on screen space reflections, and underneath color management, I'm going to set the look to high contrast. And underneath the samples right here, I'm going to be setting this to 50 so it renders a little bit faster. Once we do that, we are ready to render. So in the output settings, I'm going to change this to a movie file. Open up the encoding and set the video container right here to MP4. Once we've done that, we can save our project and then set an output right here. Once you do that, you can go up to render and click on render animation and it will render it out. We'll take a look at it once it's done. Okay, the render has finished and this is our result. To view the animation, you can open up that folder and view it there, or in Blender, if you go up to render, you can click on view animation. Then a window will pop up and you'll be able to see what it looks like. And that looks pretty cool. So there you go guys, that is the end of this tutorial. Thank you for watching. You can use this tutorial as a template for your own projects if you're using like some VFX where you're holding a bucket and you throw it up against a wall or something cool like that. I'd love to see what you create, so make sure to send it to me over on Instagram at BlenderMadeEasy. Thanks again for watching, and I'll see you guys in the next tutorial.